Thank you. How many of you are thankful that you know that one day when you stand before the Lord and you give an account for everything, that you don't have to hope and you don't have to think? You don't even have to be so cliche to say, I got a hope so, and bless God, I got a know so salvation. The song that one of the hymns simply says, it is well with my soul. You know, there's a lot of troubled nights, a lot of troubled times. And I know there's a lot of valleys and a lot of hardships. Sometimes there's times of silence. This past week, I told a couple of people things that try to encourage, but I would have to say just my own, sometimes hard times are silent times. Not when God is just being silent, God's not talking, but you ever get in that place in your life where you feel like God's just being silent? And sometimes me and Nolan ride down the road and ain't a lot of conversation. I'm being silent. Sometimes I'll be with my dad or I'll be with other people. It's just silent. And it ain't because he don't love me or I don't love my son or it's not that we don't love each other. But sometimes you just have to learn to enjoy the presence. And what I mean by that is presence, not presence. Enjoy the fellowship. You say, well, we ain't talking, ain't no fellowship. Yeah, but sometimes it's when I don't hear his voice that I learn to appreciate him that much more. It's not because God's trying to chase it. It's not because God's trying to make me chase him. Sometimes it's just times that I have to learn to find strength within myself that he gives me. It's not my strength. It's through Christ and Christ alone. I want Brother Shannon to be able to come, and you feel free if you want to. You can sing along with him, but 145, it is well. 145 in your hymn book, if you want to sing it, I encourage you, invite you to be able to do so. And I just want him to take his time to be able to sing through those verses. Did this before, but I'll say it again. Verse number 2 always gets me. Though Satan should buffet, though trial should come, let this blessed assurance control that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and hath shed his own blood for my soul. But many times old devil tries to discourage me. Sometimes he just tries to mock and he tries to taunt you. But at the end of the day, even when all things have failed, when you don't even have scripture to quote, he can't ever take away the blood of Christ. Amen. There's a lot of songs that give you comfort, and I understand that. There's a lot of songs that give you strength. Sometimes these old hymnals, these hymns themselves, they ought to be something to be able to encourage you, to understand that it is well with my soul. When life ain't well, it's still well with my soul. When I ain't singing like I want them to sing, it's still well with my soul. When everything has gone crazy, it's still well with my soul. And there's a promise that's there that you ought to keep. And I might, listen, I'm preaching now, but I'm not preaching. We got a lot of baby Christians. And I'm not talking about babies as they just recently got saved. I'm talking about a bunch of whining Christians. Maybe I say it that way. We got a bunch of whiners. I mean, I'm not being ugly, but we'll whine about everything. Whine about everything. And we wonder why we struggle because, truth be told, you know, the devil knows that he could taunt us. You know, when you're in school, you remember when you was a kid, it's that kid that got aggravated the quickest. That's the kid that everybody picked on because they like to see him get upset. Y'all with me? Say amen. Don't get quiet. Y'all know I ain't crazy. Why? Because they like to antagonize. They like to ruin. They like to stir them up. They like to get them frustrated. And that's the devil. That's the way he does us. He likes to get us frustrated. He likes to taunt us. He likes to make things and just nag at us. Why? Because he knows we're easily affected. Don't be affected by something so shallow. Amen. God's faithful. His blood is real. God never forsakes. You mind the Lord? If you want to sing, I think it's 145.
Page 145. I want everybody to sing together. If you got your hymnal in front of you, get it out with you. We're going to sing all four stanzas. It is well with my soul. Why don't you sing along with me to sing? When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrow floats like sea, billows roll. Whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say.
I want to do this a little bit different this time, or you can get anybody. You put that microphone up. I want to go back to verse number 4. And Lord, haste the day when my face shall be sight. And this is what I want to do. When we get to the chorus, I want the men to sing, the lead, and the women to do the repeat. It is well, it is well with my soul, with my soul. Everybody all right? Hey, Mike, I know they think I'm crazy, but you remember over at Vianna when they used to do that on Sunday night sometimes? Why, I wasn't even saved. And it felt like heaven just sat down. I mean, I almost want to look around and see if... Seriously? I like congregational singing. Amen. Y'all sing with me. Fourth verse. Y'all right?
And Lord, haste the day when my fate shall be sighed. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trumpet again. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul.
Amen.
If you will tonight, open your Bibles up back to the book of Ephesians, but we're going to go to Ephesians chapter number 4, and Ephesians chapter number 4. How many of you went home today and told your wife or told your husband, did you listen to that message? Anybody do that? Oh my, I must be the only ungodly husband because I think I heard it about 15 times today, amen. You better practice what you preach, amen. I got one boy over here who says, yeah, I heard my mama tell my daddy that. Amen. Amen. Ephesians chapter number 4. Ephesians chapter number 4 is where we're going to be this evening. And I want to share just something that really does go hand in hand. Truth be told, a lot of times we don't quite comprehend that our words are really as effective, maybe even more effective, maybe even more painful, detrimental, might even have more of an impact on people than our actions. Now, it's the other way around. When you say you love God, it's one thing. Anybody can say they love God. But somebody that lives it, you believe, they practice what they preach, you have a lot of respect for them. But see, what's so ironic is the flip side of that. So many times, whenever people begin to act a certain way, they can act a certain way. But when they say something, you ever notice how sometimes people's words will linger in your mind longer than their actions? When somebody lashes out at you and speaks to you and says that you're stupid or ignorant or you'll never matter for anything or there's no hope for you. Even though they come and they support you at your graduation and they help you when you're at the ball games and they're there whenever you're at the company picnic and they show that they care, it seems like it's those words that cut deeper than anything else you could ever dream of. Ephesians chapter number 4, he talks a great deal about words. But there's one verse that I want to start off as we begin to unfold this. And it's found in verse number 15. The Bible says this, but speaking the truth in love. But speaking the truth in love. It don't say just speaking truth. And it don't say just tiptoe and pat everybody on the back and love them. No, it says speak truth in love. He goes on further down, and the Bible says this. It says, speak truth in love may grow, but speaking the truth in love may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. So he says that there is a purpose, there is a desire, there is a point for you to be able to speak a certain way. But yet the truth be told, it needs to be by the truth and the truth alone. But if you speak the truth without love, you're really not anything but somebody that is a legalist, somebody that can even be mean and hateful and dogmatic. Sometimes you could say the truth, and when you ain't got love, somebody might be hurt a lot more than you'd ever think. I wonder how many of you men get up and say, honey, you need to put your makeup on.
Come on.
Right. Yeah. I wonder how many of you wives get up and say, honey, you need to brush your teeth. In other words, your breath stinks. But we try to help, but I love you anyway. You know, or we see somebody, you know, or how about this? A lot of times when I'm preaching, what do? Now, y'all know I love you, right? And then, you know, the very next thing is getting ready to be this serious statement. But this is what the Bible says. You know I love you, right? I mean, I love you. You know, Brother Danny, me and you, we're tight. Everything's good. I want to make sure everything. Okay, now let me tell you what I'm thinking. As if that makes it any better. But see, sometimes even though we don't always understand how this kind of parallels with it, it's the influence sometimes and it's the investment sometimes that makes you be able to have an impact. Why? Because when people see that you really love the way you should, listen to me, when people see that you really care the way you should, truth be told, you can say a lot more to them than you ever thought you could. But see, the reason why we don't have liberty always speaking truth, what you know the Bible says. Let me say this. If you can't do nothing but speak to somebody about what the Bible says, the best thing you ought to do sometimes is keep your mouth shut. And the reason I'm saying that is because if you can't take time to love somebody and invest in somebody, then there's no reason to call them out about their sin and about what they do wrong and how they're not living up to life. You say, well, that's hypocritical. That's contradicting to the Word of God. But why did Jesus do that with the woman at the well? My Bible says that she got up. When she got there to the well, Jesus was sitting there waiting. He had a conversation with her. He began to talk to her. He showed how can thou be a Jew, have some kind of dealing with me, a Samaritan? There's no way. Do you know your people's going to hate you, Jesus? He said, yeah, but that's all right. Because I care more about you than I do what everybody thinks about me. Everybody all right now? See, it's different when you see it in the Bible. Because what you see is you see that Jesus operated that way. Jesus functioned that way. Jesus lived that way. He loved people. He invested in people. Amen. And he took time to be able to slow down and to be able to literally invest in their life and speak to them to where they knew that he cared about them. And he didn't come because the Bible says that he didn't just come to be able to give the law. Thank God he came to fulfill the law. Amen. He fulfilled the law. So here we are. Thou shalt not live. Thou shalt not lie. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not commit adultery. I mean, listen, we got all of these requirements and all these laws. The truth be told, we can't live by all of them. But Jesus came that even though we're not perfect, that we might be set free. Why? Because he loved us. That's why the Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Yes, he told us that we were sinners. Yes, he said, for all of sin and come short of the glory of God. Yes, he said, but the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Yes, we were put in our place by reading the Word of God and the Holy Ghost, but then we would turn to be able to look to the cross of Calvary and the grave that on the third day where Jesus overcome hell, death, and the grave, and because he loved us, he left heaven's best, and thank God because he died for me, even though I'm wicked and wrong, I will submit to him. Why? Because he loves me. But he says that's the way we're supposed to speak to people. Speaking truth in love. What is truth? Truth is something that must be a standard. It must have a standard to measure to reality. Truth is not what you think. It's not how you feel. Truth is not what your mindset is. Truth is not your heritage. Truth is not what your mama said and your teacher said and your best friend said and what Dr. Phil said. Truth ain't what every church said. Truth ain't what every preacher says. Truth is what the Bible says. It's God's perspective on the matter. That is truth. If you're ever going to evaluate the way you speak, now I want to say this. Some people think, well, I'm getting tired of hearing about the way I speak and get tired about the way I love my wife and love my husband. Well, listen, maybe all you want to do is be able to live this life full of grace because of what Jesus done. But you need to get up to a point where you grow up and realize that he didn't just give his life for us. We need to give our life back to him. Let your light so shine before the world. Amen. That way they might see your Father. That's what it's all about. Speaking truth in love. It's not your opinion. It's what God says about the matter. Amen. And he begins to unfold these things. He begins to give us the standard of helping us understand that truth is the Lord's mindset. I said this a couple weeks ago and I'll say it again to you. The Bible does say in the book of Proverbs, chapter number 18, verse number 21. I said it this morning, matter of fact, that the power of death and life is in the tongue. Here the Bible says speaking truth in love. You know, there's a lot of people in the independent fundamental Baptist movement. Man, we got it all figured out. We'll tell people what we think. We'll put them in their place. We know what we're talking about. But you know, at the end of the day, we don't love them. If we loved them when they fell back down in the ditch and they fell back down in the mold, we would go back after them when they were sitting in the mud hole. Right. If we loved them, we wouldn't let them linger out there and say, well, they're going to make their bed, they're going to lay in it. Now, if you loved them, you would go out there and position yourself so they can get back to Jesus because of what you did for the cross of Calvary. If you love them, you'll quit mocking them. If you love them, you'll quit gossiping about them. If you love them, you'll quit putting them down and say, well, I knew she never changed and I knew he never changed. Shame on you. Shame on you that you've ever let such words come out of your mouth that you knew. No, you did not know, sir. No, you did not know, ma'am. Why? Because you are not God. Only God knows that. Only God has the authority to be able to say, I knew I know. You didn't know you was right. You got lucky you was right. And God let you see your pride because you want to step up and say, you know everything. You don't know everything. Keep your mouth shut. Your opinion's not always the gospel. And the Bible says that there is truth. There is death and life in the power of the tongue. That means you can cut somebody down and ruin them. They'll never come back to church because of the way you talk. Or maybe, because of the way you talk. They'll say, man, I tell you, God must love me because they ain't gave up on me yet. They keep telling me God's faithful. They keep telling me what God did for them. They might not quote no scripture, but they just keep bragging about how the Lord keeps showing up. And I know she ain't perfect, and I know he ain't perfect. Man, they don't cuss God. You know, I wonder how Job's friends felt. You know, just cuss God. Just turn back. I mean, you a heathen. Just admit it. Get your life right. I wonder how his wife felt. Even though she was bitter, undone, she lost everything too. And I understand that. But here Job is. I mean, he's still standing right, living right. I would dare say that they had a pursuit after God after they seen a man like that live for God and still speak life. I mean, he never cussed God. He never turned back on God. He never put God down. Why? Because he says, I know that God is faithful. Why? My Redeemer lives. He had confidence. He spoke life in his words. And so many times we're so analytical, and that leads us to be so critical. And then because we're so critical, it turns around and we think that we've got it all figured out. The Bible tells us in Job chapter number 19, verse number 2, listen to this. How long will ye vex my soul and break me in pieces with words? The Bible says not only is there death and life in the power of the tongue, the Bible says that you can be cut by the tongue. You don't have to uplift your hand, but I wonder how many of you ever been cut by the tongue. Right. Oh, I've been cut. Right. Hey, matter of fact, I've been cut so deep, I've always said those closest to you will cut you the deepest. You know, listen, I've had people out in the world, man, they can say anything about me, and I don't care. It don't make no difference to me. You don't know me, don't know my family, don't know anything about me. So be it. But it's those people, it's that mom, it's that dad, it's that friend, it's that brother in Christ, that sister in Christ, that one that prayed with you at the altar in the very next week. They're cutting you deep because they're speaking something, and they're letting their mouth go beyond their mind, and they're not thinking about, is this what Jesus wants me to say? So instead, they're speaking truth. They're putting you in your place, but the truth be told, they're cutting you deeper into what they see. I wonder these kids over here, these teenagers, how many of you have spoke a word to them that hasn't been critical? I wonder when's the last time that you don't have a teen over here and you have went out of your way to speak encouraging words to a teenager. I wonder how many of you got a teenager and you went out of your way to speak encouraging word to another teenager that didn't spend a night with your teenager. But I can promise you, you let that other teenager do something your teenager shouldn't be doing, and you will quickly let your tongue begin to say or speak words and putting them in their place. Well, I got to be protective over my home. You do. You do. But anybody can sit back and assess a situation. Anybody can sit back and talk about the problem. Show me somebody that's going to be a hero and be part of the solution. Maybe that young lady needs to know that the value of her is deeper than what the world sees. Maybe that lady needs to know that the value of her is deeper than what everybody else in this world is living, and that God loves her. And even though she might not have a mom or daddy at church, and maybe she don't have a lot of friends, hey, that Jesus died for her and that she's a blessing because the way that she talks, the way that she smiles. You say, well, her skirt's too short. I mean, it's immodest. I understand that. But truth be told, some of you dresses, your dress is as long as your tongue. Oh, yeah. I can't tell you the times when I started youth ministry that I'd see people come. And man, they'd wear Budweiser shirts, and we'd ask them to turn inside out. And man, they'd come in here, and they'd have a short skirt. They'd have tight pants. Now you got boys and girls with skinny jeans. God help. Man, I was up here. Well, it don't matter. Amen. Oh.
Amen.
We're going to take up a love offering. And instead of buying choir robes, we're going to buy youth robes. Amen. I'm just kidding, y'all. Y'all look up here. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. Brother Jason's being funny. Everybody good? Smile. All right. I'm just kidding. And listen, let me go deeper. Is it their fault? But I wonder how many of them say, well, they're dressing like a whoremonger. I wonder how many of you thought that. Well, the Bible's not going to hold me accountable for that. Well, the Bible says for a man to think in his mind upon a woman, he committed adultery in his heart. Your words matter. And the Bible says that words can cut so deep. Deep. James chapter number 3, and I'm not going to go there. I preached there a couple weeks ago, but I was thinking about it as I was. You know, he made a comment, and this is what the comment meant. He said, he that bridleth the tongue, he controls the whole body. He made a point that if you can control this, you can probably control everything else in your life. He gave illustration after illustration after illustration. He talked about the different things about the fire. He talked about how the horse and the helm of the boat. He talked about how there's so much potential with different things. He talked about how in the world, you know, we could actually go and the beast being there. You can't control it. How our mouth sometimes can be uncontrollable. How it can cause a great devastation. It could destroy us at the end. And I'll be honest with you. There's been a lot of times I've seen people. Man, they love the Lord. Man, they get in the choir and they'd be up here singing. I remember when I first got saved, I thought everybody that went to Haynes Baptist Church had halos over their head. Key word, thought. And I was one of them. Somebody say amen. Man, I wasn't saved long. And all of a sudden, I'd go, we'd sit down at the dinner table. And I'd start hearing the way they talk. I thought, man, I'm saved. And I mean, what in the world? I almost wanted to look over the table and push my food aside and say, y'all talk about me like that? Here I was, a young Christian. Young Christian. How to differentiate between who's real and who's not real. How to live and how not to live. Listen, and I'll go a little bit deeper. Maybe the men's fishing trip. Maybe the ladies' activity. Maybe the things that you do. I wonder how many of these young ladies and young Christian girls that they're supposed to be selling out for the Lord Jesus Christ, but whenever they go around with you and they listen to your conversation, you're not talking about spiritual things. You say, yeah, but on the outside of church, I'm human. I ought to live life. Yeah, but you ought to have enough backbone, enough respect for God. God, that if you're not responsible enough to watch the way you talk, the way you live, what you listen to on your radio, have enough decency not to be a role model the way you are at all times.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Amen. Because you'll be the first one to let your tongue get long and you start saying something when somebody messes up. Well, you know, that's just the way they are. No, you know, they're the way they are because the ones they looked up to wasn't the way they should have been. Amen. Preach on, Brother Jason. Preach on. And we wonder. We wonder. And he goes a little bit deeper. He says, how? How can such negativity, James 3, how can such negativity and such positive, how can such good and bad come out of the same mouth? You ever notice that? How can such good and bad come out of the same mouth? The Bible says it ought not to be that way. So it's fair to say that tonight, it's important that we speak truth. Now I want to say this, and I'll give you one point, and I'll be done. It's got 15 points with it, but one point will be done.
Preach on, brother. You don't do
it. Truth. Can I challenge you to just speak truth? Amen. Could I encourage you to speak truth? Can I go a little further and say it's okay for you to feel the way you want to feel as long, since I'm being blunt, as long as you keep your mouth shut about it?
Right.
Right? Sometimes, you see this right here? That looks like I love you. No. Hey, brother. God bless you. But if you only knew.
Right.
I'd rather give an account for my faults to God than I would to hurt somebody else and still give an account for that and hurt somebody else. You know, one thing I've learned as having a 10-year-old little boy, he's not even getting old yet. And I'll say, let me just publicly apologize because this got me when I was studying this. I'm hard on my boy about a lot of things. Sometimes I get frustrated because I think, Nolan, do you not know what's going on, son? And I'm not being silly. I mean, as a father, I failed here, and I want to do better. I never say, are you just stupid? Are you ignorant? Or how about this word that people say that they shouldn't say, retarded? That's a hurtful word. Shame on that. I don't say stuff like that to my son. Boys, y'all pay attention. It matters to y'all too. But I wonder how many times say, are you not getting this? Do you really not have as much figured out as I thought you? Are you ever going to grow up? Do you know that people will grow up having that image of themselves because of your words? Whose job is it to teach them to be patient? Whose job is it to teach them to be responsible? Whose job is to teach them how to figure things out or learn to figure things out? So if you're going to call them something, understand this, parent, you're calling yourself the same thing because the apple don't fall far from the tree. That tree done fell with it, amen. When I was growing up, I heard a lot of things, and in my mind, I thought I really had this image of me. I did. I'll go deeper. I heard a lot of things about the way my daddy treated my mom that I shouldn't have never heard. And the innocent mind, my daddy was my hero. Who's to say my daddy was wrong? I was innocent. I didn't know no better. Maybe that's the way a daddy treats a mama. Now, you and I know that's not the truth, but that's the power of words. I say that for this. Listen to me, because I need to move on. Think about what you say before you say it.
Amen.
That's all I'm saying to you.
Amen.
Even if it's to your spouse,
yes,
if it's to your children, if it's to your mom and your dad, think about what you say. Think about what frame of mind that person is. Think about what they're dealing with. Think about what they've been through. Think about where they just came from. Think about how they might be bitter at a situation that you have been thankfully enough to ever not have to deal with. You know, the Bible says just forgive. Just let it go. Well, maybe you ain't never been done wrong the way they have. And here you're belittling them, but you ain't never dealt with that problem. You ain't never dealt with that pain. You ain't never dealt with that addiction. You ain't never dealt with that scar. And you make it sound so simple that you make them sound stupid. We don't understand. We tear people apart that way. We tear them apart. And listen, I'm bad. Because I can tell you, I know, just me, if I walk away, I'm not running, but I would rather get, I'd rather get away for, I need to calm down. Anybody else ever get that way? I mean, sometimes just like, whoa. I mean, I'm serious, because it's like a raging war, and I'm being too transparent, probably not, but when I get going, I ain't going to shut up. When I say God, when he saved me, he changed my temper. He changed my temper, but I still live in the flesh. Because my words will hurt. The things that I've done in my life, I'm not as ashamed of as some of the words that I've said. Honestly. Because I chose to say that. I chose to say that. And the truth be told, if you were as honest as I'm trying to be, you chose to say that because you knew it would hurt them, hopefully as much as you hurt on the inside. So you just wanted to put them in their place. You wanted to tell them what they really are and what you really think about them. And the truth be told, you might be right about their nature, about their personality, but it ain't your job to speak it. You're not the Holy Ghost. I need to hurry. So Ephesians 4:29, notice this if you will with me tonight. The Bible says this, let no corrupt communication proceed out of thy mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. Amen. I want to say this to you tonight, evaluate your words and see if it's something that would please God. And I want to tell you that the Bible is very plain, that ungodliness and godliness should not come out of the same mouth. You shouldn't gossip out of the same thing that you praise the Lord with. Right. One man said it this way, I was reading a book. He said, if you want to know somebody's gossiping, just say, can I quote you to that? But like, nah, don't quote me to that. You're gossiping. How many times have I said it behind the pulpit? He who gossips to you is going to gossip about you.
Right.
And don't, oh no, we're best friends. We never do. I've seen best friends split hairs and get upset too.
Amen.
Oh yes. So he says, corrupt communication. What's corrupt? The truth. What's corrupt? Corrupt is anything unhealthy. From profanity to gossip to issues, don't let any corrupt communication proceed out of thy mouth. But that which is good to the use of edifying. I'm going to get there in a minute. You know what edifying means? To build up. Can I ask you a question? Is everything you say building somebody else up? No, because I want them to know how they make me feel. Well, now you're being honest. The Bible says only that which edifies. You say, well, I can't find nothing positive about them. Say, well, praise the Lord. God sure does look good on you, amen? Let not corrupt communication. Here's one thing I want to put to you. What's corrupt communication? So that means communication's a tool. Do you agree with that? Words are tools. They're instruments. But it said that it might minister grace unto the hearers. How many of you would you agree that unless the Lord does something at the right time, unless the soul be ready to receive the seed, it's not going to receive the seed? It's the same principle with speaking. If the timing of the truth you speak, if it's in love, if it's not when God says, say it, it may never minister grace unto the hearers. Sometimes the people we talk to ain't ready to hear the truth. Sometimes even though we love them, they're not ready to understand God's perspective about it. Sometimes people need to grow up, and though you believe they're where they need to be, they're not exactly in that location and that position. Sometimes you need to bite your tongue and say, Lord, are they ready to receive this? Because if not, you might say the truth and you might speak it in love, but if it ain't the right time, you're still out of the will of God. Everybody all right? Now, honey, you know I love you, but we need to talk in our family devotion, knowing good and well he done had a bad day. He spilled coffee on the way to work, and somebody just made him mad. He hung up with somebody at the job. And here you are, honey, you know I love you. Now, I think I love you, baby, but you've just acted on edge lately. Well, you spoke it in love. And you spoke the truth. But I can promise you, your timing ain't right, because he's going to jump up and say, well, bless God, you're right. You talking to me, I'm going to blow my gasket on you. I'm mad if everybody calling me. If the timing ain't right, sometimes you got to let it go. I'm preaching to somebody. I mean, because it's me, if it ain't nobody else. I can't tell you the times I mess up. I mean, I feel like I walk around like this all the time, my foot in my mouth. I do. Trying to help somebody. I just tried to help them. Well, truth be told, I said the right thing. Man, I love them. Everything's good. But if it ain't the right time, I ruined it. I ruined it. You know the tragedy? We might not get but one chance. I've probably spent... Miss Deborah, come. I need to give you another point so y'all keep your Bible open. I've probably spent since October 3rd at least four, on average, about four days a week speaking to my father or talking to him ever since October 3rd. And there's been a lot that we've talked about. Been a lot that we discussed. Been a lot that I wanted to say. But there's so many things I just want to look at him and say, Dad, blah, 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 blah. And the Holy Ghost just won't let me say it. I love him. I could almost grab him by his ears and say, would you listen to me? You ever get somebody like that that's lost in your life and you love them so much? Truth be told, you're hanging out. Things are great. You might be hunting, fishing together. You might be getting your nails done. And everything's good. The relationship is strong. And you just want to get them and say, maybe the timing's right now. But if you said something, they love you because you're not trying to shove Jesus down their throat. But when the Holy Ghost softens the heart, that's the time to step in and say, but can I be honest with you, Daddy? There's a lot of people tonight, in my own strength, I could go and I could knock on their door. And with a humble heart, I could apologize for the thousandth time. I could humble myself and try to just say truth and just take responsibility. I could. But the greatest thing that affects me is how I am accountable for the timing of what I say. And there's too many people relying on me being patient and selfless enough to speak it when God wants me to speak it. Because you see people get so complacent, so bitter, so mad, so distant in life that you just think if I could just get them to focus on me, just look at me. Look me in my eyes. You know I'm telling you the truth. The greatest pain is that you don't control God's timing. And you want to know what's greater? Is God might not ever give you the appropriate time to say what you know needs to be said. And you still have to trust the Lord. So how do I overcome that, Brother Jason? You do what God wants you to do, and God will take care of the rest. The Bible says that it may minister grace to the hearers that's edifying. Edifying means to build up. I guess the best thing I can ask you tonight is that everything you say, does it build somebody up? Does it help them? It says in there to edify is to be able to have the purpose of what you say. So timing is just as important as the truth. Would you agree with that?
Sure.
You know, the Bible says that the power of death and life is in the tongue. Listen to this. I'm done. Can you breathe life into life? Is that possible? Can't add to it. Can you breathe death into death? You can't. Can you bring death into life? Oh yeah, because there's room. See, the timing's not right. When life and life is there, nobody's going to receive it. Why? Because it's so full of life. When death is there, don't need no more death because it's full of death. But when something's life, there's room. You can speak death into life and you can suck life out of it. But on the flip side, it can be dead and you can speak life. And when the timing's right, you'll know that what was once living. When timing's right, you'll know it's dead, and God will say, now it's time to speak life.
Amen.
The problem is, we try to control everything. Why is it important? This is what's important. Verse number 30, notice this, I'm done. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed to the day of redemption. You know why it's important? Because when you speak out of line, you grieve the Holy Ghost. Do you know who gives you life and who gives you liberty? The Holy Ghost. So when you speak death to somebody in the wrong manner, in the wrong timing, you don't just hurt somebody else, you hurt yourself.
That's right.
And then you got to live with what you said to your mama and your dad and your friend and your brother and your sister for the rest of your life. So you didn't just grieve them, you grieved the Holy Ghost in your life. Boys, y'all better pay attention. Now I'm speaking truth. Or if not y'all, my boy better pay attention. I'm done. Play that piano, please, ma'am. It's getting quiet in here. Here's how you do it. I'm done. Psalms 19, man, that stayed with me for a long time. He said, let my words be acceptable unto you, God. Do you know the best way to know what you should say, when you should say it? You need to ask God, God, if I say this, are you going to accept it? If I say this right now, are you going to not? Well, yes, she's going to accept it. Or bless God, he's going to accept it because I'm going in there. I did that yesterday. I went in there. I said, I just come to say I'm sorry. She's like, don't apologize to me. And I was like, well, Lord, I thought you told me to go in there and say I'm sorry. Why? Because timing. Here's the point. You got to make sure that everything you say is acceptable to God, because when God's pleased with what you say, God controls the heart of everybody. But if God's not pleased with it, and I want to encourage you tonight, challenge you, would you think about everything you said? Will you think about everything you said to your mom and dad? Will you think about everything you said to your mom and dad? We think about everything you said to your kids. How many times that we've yelled at them on the baseball field and the basketball court. How many times we've hollered at different things. How many times we've seen kids in church and we've criticized them. You know, it might just be good to get around this altar tonight and say, Lord, I have not built up the way I should. I've spoke truth. And God, I've done it in love, but sometimes the timing has just not been right. And Lord, they obviously ain't hearing nothing. So Lord, if it takes me, let me be sensitive to when you're ready for them to receive it. Let me be sensitive enough to your spirit to God. I'll say it at the right time. Somebody's got to be the hero, folks. Somebody's got to be the hero. Father, help us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
As the pastor, I want to thank you for viewing our video today. However, if God's dealt with your heart, we do not want to end this video without giving you a chance to be able to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. If you're there today and God's actually dealing with your heart, I want to remind you what the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That means every single one of us has had problems, issues, sin, failures, faults in our past. But the great thing is this, is that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh through the Father but by me. There is a way to be able to have hope, to have eternal security within the Lord Jesus Christ, to be able to know that you're saved by the grace of God. Now, the great thing about the Bible is it tells us about the love of God. He says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And that's amazing to a lot of people, and they can quote it. But the beauty of it is this, is the very next verse tells us the purpose of Christ. Because the Bible says, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, that the world through him might be saved. That means that God sent his Son to die for those of us who are sinners so that we can have fellowship with God himself. Now, if you're there today and God's really been dealing with your heart, I want to ask you this question. Do you really believe that God's been dealing with you about salvation? If that's the case today, then I want to tell you what you need to do is repent of your sins. You need to die to yourself. Admit that you're lost and you're on your way to hell. And then look at what the Bible tells us, that he tells us that we can be saved through Christ. Who do you call on? There's only one. As the Bible says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. It's only through Christ and Christ alone. So I tell you today, would you trust in Christ? I want to ask you, would you trust in him as a personal Savior? You say, Brother Jason, I don't really know if I can do that. Well, let me tell you, the Bible also tells us that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It don't matter who you are, where you come from. God sent his Son to die for everyone. If you've made this decision today to be able to trust in Christ, to be able to die to yourself, to be able to start living for Christ and accept him as a personal Savior after repenting, would you do us a favor and be able to contact us at 336-788-0551 and let us know about this decision that you made so we can start praying for you. Thank you so much.